there is a causal principle operating in this world that is alien to the modern mind based on force. The modern mind thinks that causality is a matter of a force acting on a mass. So we have, for example, in most countries, a prison system based on force. The concept of deterrence is a force-based concept. We're gonna, I know you would, if you could have your way, you would rob people and exploit people and harm the world because all you care about is yourself. So we're going to impose a deterrent so that it is no longer in your self-interest to do these nasty things. It's based on a view of human nature that goes back all the way to Darwinian selfish genes. It goes even farther back to original sin. It goes even farther back to the origin of good and evil as concepts, which do not occur to the ecological mind. Another causal principle is operating in the world, that when I am cognizant of that principle, I know that the work in the prisons and all of the other healing work that might operate on a very small scale is having an enormous effect on the future, pulling deep threads of causality that might not surface for many generations. Even though the rational mind says, okay, you know, yeah, maybe you're going to work with prisoners, but really, in the context of climate change, in the context of nuclear Armageddon, what good is that going to do? These people are not going to be big influencers. You know, if you want to change the world, you better work with some influencers, not with some people who are going to come out of prison and maybe they're going to get a job at Chipotle if they're lucky. You know, you got to work with some influencers who are going to have a big platform and change people's minds. But the world doesn't actually work that way. When we set out to do big things, we end up competing with everybody else who's trying to do big things and adding to the field of competitiveness. Instead, if we want to align with the more beautiful world our hearts know is possible, rather than pursuing bigness and the kind of change that we can measure that generates big quantities of here's how many prisoners we helped, but instead we focus on beauty, we focus on love, then the bigger changes can organically coalesce around that without our ambition for it to be big. It's the principle of morphic resonance that Rupert Sheldrake articulated, that any change that happens in one place creates a field of change that makes that same change start happening everywhere else. So maybe you do adopt a prisoner. Maybe you're just working with one prisoner who's come out now and is in society. And it seems really small. And part of you is like, this isn't going to help the world. It's just going to help one guy, you know? But actually what you are doing is you are reinforcing that field of compassion. And because you are doing that, it's going to start happening other places too. And it works the other way as well. Like, what is moving in you that wants to act on compassion right now, that is sourcing from somewhere this impulse toward kindness, this impulse toward love? What is giving you courage to step out of self-interest, to step out of security, to step out of self-protection, to step out of the habits that trauma may have lodged within you, to say, you know what, I'm going to serve instead. I'm going to serve what I care about. I'm going to serve what's beautiful. What are you drawing from when that happens? You are drawing from the invisible contributions of humble people who did just that and have been doing that for centuries. From time immemorial. And maybe they thought that they weren't changing the world, but they are through the vehicle of everybody who's tapping into that field. And if someday we have a political leader who also is taking those steps of courage, it's not that all of a sudden we elected a Superman. It's that the collective field had reached a point where such a leader could step into it.